Hello everyone. Is the sound okay? Please confirm it in the chat. Yep, perfect. So the thing is, this talk is prepared to be talking in English, okay? For those who doesn't know me, my name is Martin Cristóbal. I'm the founder of the channel Beta Tech on YouTube. And please subscribe if you don't follow me already on that platform. So the talk of today is going to be Git, because I think that it's a really good tool to share and to make work with teammates together. Also in these times in which this hackathon is online, so all of you will be in your homes alone. And you need to talk with your teammates to work together to share the code you are making. So I thought that making this Git talk, the first one of the hackathon, would provide really useful insights on how you can share your work and work together in a better way. And also, it's one of the most used tools across all the teams in the development atmosphere. So I hope that this talk provides you with some good tools and insights on how to use and to learn Git. The thing is, how we will present this talk in the following, I think it will take around 40 minutes or something like that. Let me present first these slides I made. The thing is, I will first start talking about what is Git, what will it provide for you, and more or less how is it made. And then we will start doing some practical things with the terminal, with command line. We will create a Git repository. We will upload it to GitHub. And then we will do some things that I think are cool, like pull requests. And we will learn how to merge conflicts, okay? Those things are, I think, are the basis to use Git. And I think it will be the basic tools you will be using during this hackathon. So with this, we can start talking about what the heck is Git, okay? Well, Git is, first of all, an open source tool. So it's free to use. We don't have to pay anything to use Git. If you want to install Git in your machine, you must download it from the gitssm.com webpage. But it's also possible that you already have Git installed in your machine. Obviously, if you want to check if you have Git installed, what you can do is just run the Git command. So if you see an output like this, that the Git command is doing something, you're good to go. Otherwise, you would need to, first of all, download Git for Windows, for macOS, or for Linux, depending on in which machine you are working on. Okay? So first of all, while I'm explaining like the theory of Git, you're free to go to this page and to download whatever you need to make usage of Git, okay? So, as I said, it's an open source tool. So if you're interested also, sorry, I forgot to show you that, you can also check the code of Git in Git. It's stored in GitHub. It's like a Git, well, it's the Git repository for Git. So if you're interested or you're curious, you can go here and show the code and watch the code. Okay, so you can also have the commits, branches, all of it. So, first of all, it's a version control tool. So, what does it mean? Git is a version control system, meaning it's used to track changes and coordinate the work made on the projects across all of your teammates, of multiple people. So, for example, imagine that you work in a team with multiple developers, like you will do in this hackathon, and you're working like to push a new version of your software. Let's say that it's version 2.0, okay, to production. So you are working on the features of the version 2.0, but then a bug is reported in an older version of your software. Imagine that a client is using like version 1.6, let's say, and he found a bug and reports it. So you want to be able to fix that bug even if you're working on the 2.0 version. What happens? That because you're working on the 2.0 version, you have like a state of your code that it's really different than what was in the 1.6 version. And also, you will not want to wait until you deploy the 2.0 version, because the 2.0 version, maybe it's planned to go live at the end of the year. And you don't want to wait that year to fix that bug for the client, because clients get angry. So, and that's one of the problems that Git solves. Git allows you to maybe go back to the state of the code in which version 1.6 was, and fix that bug there and deploy that version specifically. Okay, you will see how to do that later in this talk. Then, more reasons to use Git. Teamwork. Okay, basically it's teamwork. You normally would think that your team is more or less like this. Okay, it's all happy, all coordinated, all working for the same purpose. Maybe all of you working in the same laptop, which is a common practice. But normally it's more chaotic than this. Okay, normally it would seem, if you're not using it, the code that you are producing would be more like this. Okay. Maybe designers out there would be familiar with this outcome of files, okay? You never know which is the last version, the working version that you can show to your clients. And you are obviously always making copies of the last version, your new final. This time, yes, it's the final, okay? So that's another reason that Git is useful for. So two basic reasons. One of them being a control of changes, so that you can track which changes to do, where to make the changes, etc. And two, to control versioning and changes from your team. Okay. So how does Git do that? Some people think it's more or less like magic. Well, in some ways, it seems to be. So let's talk first about more or less how Git is constructed, or more or less how does Git work, okay? Or the concepts, the basic concepts behind the usage of Git. So Git, the highest thing in Git or entity in Git would be the repository. The repository are your projects, okay? It's a repository is like a bucket. In this bucket, all the information about all the changes you and your team made to the code are saved, so you can view them, you can move across the changes, you can revert changes, etc. And the way these changes are organized is with commits, okay? Commits are the unit of change in a Git repository. When you make a commit, you are saying to Git, please register this change I made into the repository. So every time you commit new changes, it registers the changes that you made into the repository, so that later on you can backtrack, you can check the changes that has been made, and you can check who made the changes. Okay. And then how are the commits grouped, or how are the commits organized? Are organized in branches. You also can see branches like a timeline of changes. Okay, like a timeline of commits. When you start a new repository, only one timeline exists, which is the branch master. Every time you want to experiment with new features, or you want to start developing something, you can create a new branch. You can create a new timeline and diverging from the original one. This allows you to, for example, return to your original state, return to the point when you created this new timeline safely. Okay, so all the changes you are making into this new timeline would not affect the original timeline unless some action that we will see later is made, which is called a merge. But if you don't merge to the old timeline, you're totally safe to do whatever you want in the new timeline because the original one would not be affected. Okay? So, this permits us to have the changes controlled and secured, which I think is important in a software project because we could have like a team of hundreds of people and hundreds of files in the project. So it's good to have some tool to prevent these things to get out of control. So, as I said, this is like theory, concepts that without practice doesn't mean anything. So I think it's more interesting now to show you pues, and how to work with Git and to learn how to use Git in this hackathon particularly with your projects. Okay, so if you let me get out of PowerPoint, we can get to our terminal and start doing some things with Git. So first of all, imagine that this is your folder, okay? You have your project folder. Mine is hack from home Git. And then we want to start our new Git repository. If you have Git installed, I hope that the 92 people that are seeing this live stream have already Git installed. To start a new Git repository is so easy. You just need to type git init. Okay, you can see here the message that initializing repository git in this folder. So what does this command do? If you write now to list the hidden folders, you can see that a new folder called .git is now created. This folder is where all our repository, all our changes, all our heads, later I will explain what are the heads, will be saved. So we can enter this repository, sorry for the typo. And we can see that we have here some files, okay? One important thing is the folder called refs. Here you can see like we have heads and tags. Let's explain now what is the head. As I said, we have like multiple timelines in a Git repository. We can have multiple timelines, or even we can be in a state which is an older change. Heads is like what you are looking at. Imagine that it's your head, you're looking at a timeline, so which node, which change are you looking at? This will be the state, the actual state of your repository. So in this case, we only have one timeline. We have the master timeline, which is called here. So let me just print the contents of the head file. We see that we are looking right now at the master timeline, the master branch, okay? So every time we are creating new timelines on, or we are creating like different states of our code, we can move the head around, which is what we call, we can go back to another state of our code. Okay? So let's start doing something with Git. Let's add a new file, which would be file.js. We would make a simple program, as a program that only outputs something to the console. But I think it's really useful to use that to see in which state we are currently at in the code, because we will be changing the message in based of different settings of the Git repository. Okay. So we create a file which is file.js, and now we can check what is the status of our repository. As you can see in my terminal, some lightning appear here. That's because I have some things installed that already tell me the state of the repo. But the normal command to check the state of the repo is git status. If you make git status, it tells you some things. One of them being in which branch you're currently in, if you made some commits, and which files are not added to the commit, okay? This is called the staging area. The staging area is the intermediate step between the changes you are doing and the commit being registered. So it's like having a box in which you put the files, you put the changes here, and then when you commit, it's like closing the box and giving it a label, and then going to the next thing. Okay, so every time you have the box open, you didn't commit anything, you can move around the things inside that box. You can modify the staging area. How do you modify the staging area? For example, here we have the box of the staging area empty. So we would need like to add the new file to the box, to the staging area. How we do that? Well, Git already told us what to do. We can use git add and put the name of the file. If you make again git status, we see that the file has been added to the staging area box. Okay, we see that because it says new file and is file.js. So now we have the box open with the file inside of it. We want to register the change and make a commit. How we can do that? Really easy. The only command you need is git commit. Okay, to make git commit, and then it asks to you what label do you want to set in the box. What is the commit message? This is important because commit messages is what most of the people use to check the changes. One thing it's usually recommended to put in the commit message is why you make the change. No, not the change you made. I mean, if I change the text of the of some string of some variable, the commit message would need to reflect why we needed to change that constant, not that we change that constant, because that will be already registered by Git. So the people will see already that that constant has been changed. It's important to see why that constant had been changed. Okay? How do you went to master? Master is the first branch of the repo, so we already are in master when you init a Git repository. If you have any question and you want to ask, I'm looking at the chat right now, so feel free to ask anything, okay? So we make this commit and we simply insert a new message, okay? Will be initial commit with Vim. We save. And then it says that we committed a new change to the master branch, okay? Then, what can we do now that we have the first commit done? We can use git log. Git log is like to see, it's the command to see the historic of changes that has been made to our repository. Here, we only see the first change. We see the author, which is me. And we see the date in which the change has been made. Okay? How did you insert the commit? That's just the next thing I will explain. I inserted it with Vim on purpose, okay? I think that it's more easy to use one flag, which we will present later, which is the with an M. For example, to see this, we can open our file and we would insert our log, okay? Save it. And then if you make git status, you see that we modified the file. We added to our staging zone. Now it's added, it's in green. So now we make a commit, but this time we use minus M. With minus M, we don't have to use Vim to write our commit message. We just write the commit message right here in the command, second commit. And it's already done, okay? It's an easier way to put the commands in the Git. Then, just to show it, if I just write git log here, we have the two commits registered. Okay, so right now we have one branch, which is master, and we have two changes. We have two nodes. What can we do then? So, right now we can create, for example, a new timeline. We can create a new branch. For this, first we can see with the command git branch a list of the branches we have created in this repo, which for now it's just master, okay? If we use git branch and create, for example, new branch, now we have created a new diverging branch from master. So we take the last commit or the commit we are currently in, and then we create a new timeline that it starts from that commit. So if I now write git checkout new branch to move the head to that new branch, okay, you can see that I've changed to the new branch, and then we can modify the contents of our file. We can put new branch log, new branch log, and then if we run this command, this file, obviously it outputs new branch log. Let me do a commit. Then we have registered this change to the branch new branch, so we have in git log the head in the last commit, which is only on new branch. We have here master and master, okay, because the thing is we have the two first nodes. Let me make myself bigger to explain better. We have these two nodes, which is the first commit, the second commit, and then this second commit is shared between the two branches, master and new branch, because it started there. Then we have the new commit, which is only on new branch, but not in master. Okay, so the timeline from the new branch starts from master. If you go back enough times in new branch, you go back to master. But if we continue making changes inside master, they are not affected between the different branches. Okay, so let's keep going. If now I go back to master, what happens is that when I run the command, the log is the log that I had in my master state, in the head of the last commit of master, not the last commit of the new branch. So this way, what is useful to do here is, like, if I have a stable project and I want to develop some new feature, the ideal thing is to make a branch for that new feature. So any change I make that can break things, that it's not applied directly to my stable branch, okay? So, right now we are having like two branches and some file that is being changed, but this is only made on my local repository, which it's not useful if I cannot share this with my teammates. So the thing is, let me explain you how to upload these changes to the internet, because this repository, well, it's local, we cannot share it with pen drives or whatever. We need a way to automate our broadcasting of changes. To do this, we'll use GitHub. This is precisely where GitHub or GitLab or Bitbucket come to play, okay? So how can we synchronize our local repository with a remote repository? First of all, we have the command git remote, which right now doesn't output anything, because we haven't synced yet this local repo with our remote repo. How can we do that? Let me go to my repositories on GitHub, okay? And we will create a new repository here. If you don't have a GitHub account, I highly recommend to you to make one and to insert your code for this hackathon in some repository, like I will show you here how to create. So, first of all, let's create a new repository, which will be, what's the name of the folder? Hack from home git. And we will make it public, so if any of you wants to go back to this repository to see the commits and to see all the changes I made, you're free to go, okay? And it's really easy, just create repo. Okay, here we have some options. GitHub provides us with some options. First of all, it's quick setup. We will get rid of that. We can create a new repository from the command line. If you can see, these commands are the ones that we already used in our terminal, okay? And the interesting thing that it shared between the two states is the last two lines, okay? As you can see here, it uses the command git remote, but adds a new remote, adds the remote repository that we will be using for our local repository, okay? So it's really easy. You just need to copy this command and paste it here, okay? This adds this URL as the remote repository for your local repository. If you click enter and then you use git remote, you will see that origin, which is the name of the remote repo, it's just a name to not be writing this URL over and over. You have one registered. If you put this flag, you can see that origin refers to my GitHub repository that I just created, okay? To read and to write, which is these two permissions. Then, how can we push or upload the changes we made in our local repo to our remote repo? We can use this command here, git push. If you let me just write git push without all of these other things, you can see that this crashes, okay? Why does it crash? Because this remote repository, the repository on GitHub, does not have any branch defined yet. So we need to upload the definition of our branches, okay? So how can we do that? GitHub, tells this command, which is the same as using the command that GitHub provides, which is this one here. You can see that it's the same command if it copies. You can see that it's the same command, just that the setup stream option has been shortened to the U option. And what this does is it creates in origin, which is our remote repository, is this link here, a branch named master with the contents of our branch master. Okay? So now if we go back to our GitHub and we refresh the page, we now see our commits in a more beautiful way than not in our terminal with the changes that we made. And oops, only our first branch, only the master branch. Why is that? Because we only pushed to origin our master branch. To put our new branch to GitHub, we also need to push all the changes that we made in this branch, okay? So now if we update, we will see that we have the two branches. In this file, we have the content we had in master, which is first log. And in new branch, we have new branch log. Okay, so this is now online. How can I get the code from GitHub from remote? Okay, so if you already have a GitHub repository because another person created it and you want to download the project into your local repository, you just need to use clone or download, okay? You have two options. You can download the zip, but I recommend you to use the command git clone, okay? So if you write git clone and the link to your repo, this will download all the contents of the remote repository, all the branches, all the changes to your local repository, okay? Everybody's following until here. Any doubt? Anything? Okay, perfect. So, then, what can we do now that we have our repository in our remote GitHub account? For example, we can do one thing which is really useful that I think less teams do, but I think a lot of teams which should do it, and it's like a way of working and sharing the changes that has been made, which is making a pull request. Okay, how does it work, or what does it mean to make a pull request? Imagine that you have like your branch, and you made a new branch to develop your features. Okay, then you start developing in this another branch, you start doing things, changing things, and then committing things, and then you get to a state in which you think, or maybe all the changes has been made and everything works correctly, so it's time to put this thing in the common branch, which usually is master or develop or whatever. So when you get to this stage, you can create like a pull request, which is a way of asking politely to please merge these changes or to review these changes into the standard branch. How can we do that? Imagine that if you are like pushing your changes to your new branch, you can just click like to create a new pull request, okay? And here you can see that I'm trying to open a new pull request from the branch new branch to master with the change that I've already made. We can write a comment, we can write whatever we want, and we click create. So what does it do? It now created a new pull request in our GitHub repository. So we can go to our tab of pull requests to see it. If we click here, you can see all the changes that want to be merged into the standard timeline. And then, for example, you can review, other teammates can review the changes you make, can enter your commits, can put comments, okay, can write something. Why did you do that? You can respond to comments that your reviewers it's doing to you. So with this, it's like an organized way to merge the branches to your stable branch, because you don't want anybody or some changes that has not been tested or has not been reviewed to make its way to the standard or your stable branch, because then you have no control over what goes to production and what does not. So this way you are always asking permission to merge your changes to your stable branch. If you are a reviewer and you are receiving pull request to merge into master, you simply can go to the pull request and then click merge, confirm. And if everything works okay, it says that it has been merged. And then it's like in our master branch, we incorporated all the commits of the timeline that are in the new branch, okay? So here, for example, if we had two commits, we can see that this commit, which was made in the other branch, now it's incorporated in the master branch, and then another commit which represents the fusion of the two timelines, okay? So I recommend you to work this way, because you can have all the changes listed, you can make reviews, you can write comments on the code, and this way it provides you a tool to increase the quality and the productivity of your team, okay? So, what else can we talk about Git? We can talk about conflicts. Okay, I think that conflicts is an important thing to talk about because what I showed you, it's like the happy path. If everything works correctly, it's really easy to handle, but when conflicts start to appear, and it happened to me when I started using it, that conflicts were like my worst nightmare, okay? Every time I had a conflict, I didn't know how to solve it, what to do, what commands to run. It was like really awkward for me, okay? So I think it's useful to show to you how conflicts are generated, why conflicts do happen, and how to solve these conflicts, okay? So, first of all, let's go to master. And let's try to provoke a conflict, okay? How can we provoke a conflict? It's really easy in general, so it's normal to conflicts to happen when we are multiple team members working in the same code base or in the same file, okay? So for example, this is some content to mess with. Let's write this into a file named conflict.txt. This file would be what would generate the conflict, okay? And we add this to our staging zone, okay? Then what we can do? We can commit our change with this. Then we have registered the change of adding this new file with the contents. This is some content to mess with. And then to generate the conflict, what we will do is we will go to another branch, okay? This is also an opportunity to show to you how to generate another branch with a better command, which I think it's more useful, which is git checkout, the same command we use to change branches or to change commits with the flag -b. This will create the branch and move us to the new branch, which the name is conflict branch. Okay, so now we are in the conflict branch, and we will click in change, create another file, conflict.txt. It's the same name, but now we change the content of the file, okay? And then the same, we commit it. Git add and git commit. So now we have in master one commit changing the creating the conflict file, a new branch generated from that commit with the change of contents of that file, and now we will make the weird thing, okay? Now we will make what provokes the conflicts. We will go back to master, and we will modify again the contents of conflict.txt. Let's write the command to modify the contents. And then let's add to the staging zone and let's commit. So what will happen now? We have two branches that the last commit is a change to the same file. So now if we try to merge these two branches, we will generate a conflict, okay? How do we merge two branches? One way is through pull request, which I explained earlier, but here we will do it directly, okay? We will take the two branches and we will merge them. To do that, we use the git merge command. and we select conflict branch. Here what we are telling Git to do is to take the conflict branch and make these changes go to the master branch. Okay, so you are like pulling the changes from one branch to another. But what will happen if we do that? We have a conflict. When Git tried to fuse the changes from the two branches, it detected that we have two changes made to the same file. So he does not know what change to maintain. And this generates a conflict. What this causes is that if you put Git status, you see that here we have a conflict, and if you look into the file, it changed the file, okay? You will see these things that are really weird things. So you don't have to be afraid of this, of seeing these weird things, this head here, this equal signs here, or this branch name here. What does it mean is you here have defined what was registered in your head, in your master, and here what is the change that was registered in the other branch. So it's like a conflict pending to be resolved. You need to decide what do you want to maintain. You want to maintain this, you want to maintain this, or maybe you want to get rid of it and write another thing, okay? How can we solve this conflict? In fact, it's easy. I mean, you can always like use your editor and edit it directly, okay? Like erasing this and erasing this, and then you get this line, or erasing this, and you get this line, okay? No secrets. But there are some tools that allow you to make it easier. Let me just open Visual Studio Code to show it to you, because Visual Studio Code has some conflict solving visualization in it. For example, here it registers already that we have a file with a conflict, which is our conflict.txt. And if you just open it, you can see that it parses your weird things, your weird symbols, and it tells you like accept current change, which would be like accepting this line, or accepting coming changes would be accepting this line, okay? So with Visual Studio, for example, you can solve your conflicts in a really easy way, but if you don't want to use a visual text editor like this or some other tool like SourceTree, which I think I have website here, okay, which is another tool for using Git or for solving merge problems or all of that, you can always directly use Beam or Nano or whatever to edit your files. Then when the files are edited, the only thing you need to do, let me just solve the conflict here. We will solve the conflict like maintaining the two lines, okay? Then you just add again the file resolved and then commit. Okay, so now you have resolved the conflict and you can continue developing in whatever branch you want to develop in. So here it seems really easy because it's only two lines, but imagine a conflict in which multiple files are involved, multiple lines of the same file are involved. Sometimes it's a bit hard to keep track of all the conflicts that you have in your files if you're not using some tool. That's why I recommended to use Visual Studio Code or SourceTree to do this, okay? With this, I think that you can now work with Git in your projects. I highly recommend trying it out if it's your first time using Git or GitHub, because I think that practice makes the best learning experience there is. But before going to questions and answers, let me explain some things that you can do if you use Git, okay? Because you can do more things than not just tracking your changes or blaming whatever made some change in some file. Maybe some of you saw that in my commits I used like some words like fix, fit, or chore. I don't see it for here. Maybe here, for example. Okay. The commit message can be anything you want. Okay, can be whatever you want. But there are some tools, external tools, third-party tools, that make really good use of them. For example, one use case for this is versioning, okay? How many of you have heard about semantic versioning in the chat? You know what SEMVER is? If you don't have heard about semantic versioning, let me put the link here. Here, for example, semantic versioning is like a standard, okay, like a standard for managing versions in software. It describes the version of the software in with three numbers. Basically, the three numbers are the first one, the major, the middle one, the minor, and the third one is the patch. So you can say, for example, I have Minecraft 2.3.5, or I have this app, I have Facebook 14.8.437. Okay, it's like the version of your software. It also works normally with libraries. Maybe you've seen it with npm packages, okay, the version that you are downloading. And semantic versioning, what stipulates is that each number should be incremented only with certain circumstances, okay? The major is incremented only when a breaking change is added to the system, meaning that you cannot use, imagine it's a library, it's an npm package, it's whatever you want to make calls to it. You cannot use the same interface, or you have different interfaces in the two versions. So if you had code that consumed that library in the version 2, if you try to use the same interactivity with the version 2 with the version 3, some bad things can happen. Okay, that's with the major. The minor is only incremented when you add functionality to your software, but it's backwards compatible. So every client using your software with the version 2.1 can still use your software without changing anything with 2.2, okay? And the patch version is, for example, if you have some fix that you need to prepare or something, you increment the last number, okay? So why I'm explaining all this? Because it's like a headache to maintain this versioning with your code. If you have multiple features being developed at the same time, you have multiple people working in the same project at the same time. So using this, the semantic versioning, you can have control about the versions of your software, okay? And if you want to maintain, to do this in a really simple way, one tool that I found really useful is using precisely Git. So if you want to apply semantic versioning in an automatic manner, okay, it's really easy to use the format of the commit messages to inform the third-party tool that you're using to maintain the version, which version should use for the next release. What I'm talking about is called conventional commits, okay? It's like a standard for your commit messages. That regarding if you write a fix, or if you write a feature, or if you write a chore, you can compute the next version of your software, okay? I think it's really useful. If you are really interested in learning it, I can share the links in the Discord, okay? So just let me know and I will post the links there, okay? So I hope that this talk has been useful to you. So if you're now ready for Q&A, we'll start doing some of that. Well, I think there's a problem with the chat in the live streaming, but don't worry, I'm seeing the chat here in Twitch. Is there any question, any doubt, anything that doesn't seem to be clear? Okay. So if there is, okay, first question. Is there something fun we can do with GitHub right now? I don't know if it's fun or not, but if you are starting your projects for this hack, I would highly recommend to create your first repo in GitHub, okay? And start like pushing your changes to it. It will make your life really more beautiful along the way. Can you share the link, please? Yes, I will share it in the Discord channel. If you let me, I don't have it here. I have it here, okay. I don't know if we have any channel to put information about the talks, but I will try to put it. Maybe I'm in the Discord, and my name is Martin with BetaTech at the end. So if you want to ask me about links or insights, you can ping me in Discord, okay? I will try to share the links in some channel if I can. But otherwise, I will send a direct message to you with the links. I'm on the commit pages placing my message, but I don't know how to get out. Write this, okay? It's Beam. If you've never used Beam before, maybe it's some problem. I think that you're in a page more or less like that. Let me put it here, okay? Just write this. This at the end. This, what does is writes the file and queues it to quit, okay? If you don't write anything, you just can quit the thing. Which is the difference between clone and fork? That's a good question, okay? Cloning, it downloads your repo with all the Git and changes, commits, blah, 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 branches. And you can, it's not hardly linked to the original repository. What you do when you fork a repo is that you maintain a link between the two repositories. So, for example, if you fork one repo of my own, I think that I have some examples here, maybe. Let me go to a repo that some people forked. For example, I have this project with 13 forks, okay? If you go to any of these projects, you can specifically see that they have been forked. So you can make pull requests to the original repository. Okay, you can share branches. From this repo, he can maybe make a pull request to my repo. If you clone, I don't think that you can do that, or maybe it's not as elegant as it is when you do a fork. Okay, so if you are using your own repo, I would recommend to clone it. But if you are contributing to open source projects or other people's repositories, always do a fork. If two persons do a merge at the same time, what happens? What maybe can happen is that you can generate a conflict. Are there any other tools similar to Git? Yes, there are, but Git is the most widely used. You have, for example, Subversion. And I think there's another, but I don't remember the name. And let me just, for example, put the Subversion thing here. It's like another system for version control. But I think that 90% of the industry uses Git. So I started with Subversion in university. But I think that Git has more functions, and along with GitHub, it can have it's widely used. Okay, almost all the open source projects are other in GitHub or in Bitbucket. So the primary function of forks is to make pull requests. One of the biggest ones, yes. One of the biggest ones. I mean, it's like a tool for making contributions to open source projects, to maintaining, like, maybe you see a project that it's really good that you want to contribute to. So one way to start doing it is like fork, download it to your local repository, to Meetup, do some things, and then make a pull request, politely asking to merge some changes that that you make. Okay. Common cherry pick is possible to explain or not possible. I've rarely used the command cherry pick of Git, okay? It's useful. I'm looking at documentation right now. But well, I didn't really use the cherry pick command a lot in my working experience or anything like that. What I see that does is enables arbitrary Git commits to be picked by reference and appended to the current working head. So like you can get changes and put it out and under your current working tree. I think that a command that is more useful to learn if you want to learn more weird commands of Git is to learn rebase, because rebase enters directly in some workflows in some companies. What rebase does is imagine that you are developing a new feature, but some changes are being already applied to master. And then for you to continue to optimally make changes to your code, you need the changes that has been made to master. But you don't want to merge your changes into master because you didn't finish yet the new feature. So with rebase, what you can do is take all the changes that has been made to master or to another branch and move like this part of changes that you want to provide to your new branch into your new branch. So it's like you created the branch from the latest head of master, okay? But what it did is move all the commits that are not in your branch to your branch. So all the changes that happened in master are now in your branch, but you did not merge your branch into the original. I don't know if that makes sense or if it has been understood, but more or less it's like this. So, okay, perfect. I think we're running almost out of time. I hope that you enjoy it, that you apply Git to your workflow in this hackathon. I hope to see interesting repos coming out. So thank you very much for coming to this talk. So sorry for my bad English, but well, we have people here that that are from another countries. So thank you very much. See you next time.